Hey, everybody, this is Charles. Thanks so much for joining us on another episode of the Mindfully Masculine podcast. We will continue this week to review and discuss Self-Care for Men by Garrett Muntz. And we will also get into some other topics like Dan's triumphant return to the gym, my new audiobook purchases and my listening practices, how and why Dan and I go about waking up early. And we'll also get into hand and foot hygiene, including professional and do-it-yourself manicures and pedicures. Pretty please follow or subscribe to our show with whatever app you use to listen to podcasts. We will get to see the numbers go up, and that makes us feel good, so we super appreciate it. Thanks, and enjoy this episode.
Good morning, Charles. How are you?
I'm well, Dan. Thank you. How are you?
I'm well as well.
Good. You went to the gym this morning, huh?
I did.
Yeah.
And it's the third day in a row, and I am... three whole days, but I had gone, probably the last time I went, regularly was before the holidays of last year. So I've been, it's been a while, yeah. And I forgot all the side benefits of it, but I really tried to scale it back and say, look, I'm not going to go crazy. I'm not going to go, try and do a 2-hour workout. I'm just going to get in the habit of going to the gym. And I realized for it to stick, I need to be consistent with it. So none of these, I'm going to be 2 days on, 1 day off or whatever. I'm going to go every single day, and on whatever that workout's going to be, I'm going to do it at the gym.
Just walking green. For a day, then you're walking at the gym.
Exactly.
Gotcha.
Exactly. Okay. Yep. Yeah. Yeah. It's not lifting every day. But I have been doing that, and it's been great. So it's definitely made me more patient.
Yeah.
How's the
appetite been? Has it made you hungrier?
Not yet.
Okay.
Because I'm also not going crazy. Right. I'm not going to failure with every set. I'm not doing crazy amounts of sets. I mean, I'm maybe working for like 30 minutes to 40 minutes in the gym at this point.
You said your coach has you on a 2,000 calorie diet or something around 2,000 calories?
Yeah, he has me on that. I have not been following it.
What would you estimate would be your homeostasis maintenance calories to just stay right where you're at?
Probably 2,600.
26.
So yeah.
That's a significant cut.
Yeah. And it's just because I haven't set up my context, my environment in the right way. Yeah. I've also not been going to bed on time, and I've been watching, Netflix before bed and getting hooked on and I need to break that habit in order to get to bed earlier. If I get to bed earlier, I'm less likely to eat the longer I stay up. Once after it's like 8-9 o'clock, if I'm still awake at that point, I get hungry and I end up eating. And it's usually after I've already consumed all of my 2000 calories for the day. So, I applaud my trainer for sticking with me and not giving up on me, because I've not been following his calorie recommendations, and I haven't seen the results either because of that.
Well, as long as the checks are still clear, and he'll probably give you,
it doesn't hurt.
Always give you another shot.
Right. Yeah. 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 How are you? What's going on?
I've got a couple of books in my Audible queue that I want to listen to here soon, and I will share some of the titles with you and the audience. The Road Back to You by Ian Morgan Cron and Suzanne Stabile, I guess her name is.
Mm-hmm.
And that one, oops, hold on, I didn't mean to start the audio from it. That one is about an Enneagram journey to self-discovery.
Interesting.
So that was recommended by one of the guys in my men's group that I attend, as was this other book called The On-Purpose Person.
Uh-huh.
And I don't have a lot of details on that other than this one fella told me it was good, and he thought I might like it. The On-Purpose Person, Making Your Life Make Sense by Kevin W. McCarthy. Not the same one that was Speaker of the House, I don't think. I don't think he's writing a book about making your life make sense after he got kicked out of his job. This modern parable tells the engagingly simple story of one man's journey of going from a life filled yet unfulfilled. You'll find yourself walking in his footsteps in this easy to listen to narrative packed with practical applications and a timeless process. Define what's most important to you, clarify your wants and heart's desire, find your purpose, tap into the power of your authentic self. So that sounds right up our alley.
Yeah, absolutely. That sounds great.
Yeah, I'm hoping. And then also, I also got the third one I got was The Big Stick, which is the collected wisdom of Robert Glover.
Oh.
And so it was curated and narrated by somebody who's not him, but it basically takes all of the stuff that he's put out in his books and I assume in probably his podcasts and some of his seminars and stuff and kind of boils it down into one edited tome. So
when you have these, you've got three in your queue here. Yeah. Are you listening to all three at the same time or you could do one then the other? What's your style?
I will, when I embark on these, and I haven't started any of them yet, I will do them consecutively, not concurrently, or I'll start one. I'll finish it. I'll start one. I'll finish it. I'll start one. I'll finish it. Because I would be, I mean, especially with books, you know, it's one thing if I'm listening to, a Lee Child or Stephen King book, then maybe I could have a nonfiction book as well and not get confused. But if I'm listening to three books on personal development at the same time, even if they're only kind of related, I'm still going to get confused of who said what.
Okay. So you are a normal human being. Okay. I wasn't sure because you always have quite a few in your queue. And I was always wondering, hey, wait a minute, you know, you bank through those really quick.
Well, it's because of all the driving I do. Yeah.
And so I wasn't sure.
Yeah. The driving and the walking, which is something I need to get back into here. I need to start doing, you know, the campground that I'm staying at now has nice paved roads where I could put on.
And it's fairly sizable too. I mean, I feel like if you were to do every, you know, go kind of like serpentine through them all.
Yeah.
That might be a mile or two.
It's probably a couple miles. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. I would think so. The campground, I used to live at in DeBary, doing that whole thing was a half mile and it was quite a bit smaller than where I'm at right now. So yeah, I can get up and do my, usually I would do, when I was walking in the mornings, I would try to do a mile I'd do 3 miles in the morning. And that would usually run me right about an hour, maybe a little less.
And what time of the day was this?
Usually I would try to have shoes on my feet and be walking out the door by 5.
And was it daylight or just coming up?
Not usually. It was, okay. I mean, really, I think last time I did it was summer. Like April, May. And so.
Okay. So it was close.
I mean, at 5 a.m., there's not many times of the year where you see the sun at 5 a.m.
Yeah. When does it start hitting 6 o'clock usually? Is that summer?
I don't know. Let's see.
It's just so hard to.
What time is sunrise? Okay, so sunrise tomorrow will be at 7:18 where we are.
Yeah.
And we're pretty much in the middle of the winter. So, yeah, I would say, and then, you know, the time change messes it up too.
Oh, that's right. Know,
which that's is right. Hard for me to calculate.
Yeah, we're springing ahead.
Yeah. But I don't know. I don't know.
It's just so hard for me to get up in the mornings when it's dark out and cold out in the winter. Oof. Dude.
Well, I might need to evangelize you on the idea of getting one of those hatch alarms where
you
keep it in your bedroom and it gradually gets lighter and lighter and the music or the birds or whatever it is that you want to listen to.
Yeah.
Gradually as the light gets brighter, the music comes up a little bit and it helps me wake up early when I need to wake up early. I don't like using just a conventional alarm where 5 o'clock hits and you hear, rah, rah, rah. I can't do that.
I don't do that either. Alexa has a poor man's version of that where it's supposed to brighten up about 5 or 10 minutes before the alarm goes off. But for whatever reason, it seems like it's just like, poof, you know, like lights on a stadium kind of
the hatch
experience. It's not gradual at all. And then it does wake me up, but it is a little disturbing.
The Hatch Restore 2 is the one that I have because I had the Hatch originally. And it stopped working right. It went and joined my Wi-Fi network. And so I wrote to them about it. And they're like, oh, we'll just send you the latest model for free.
Great customer service.
Excellent customer service. And yeah, I believe I can do, I have definitely done 45 minutes of ramp up time before.
Oh,
and I think you might be able to do an hour.
That's nice.
Where it starts real.
That's pricey though. That's like a $200.
I think it was 129. I think I got a Target. Like 1,929, something like that.
Oh, all right. Yeah. Okay.
And the thing I do to increase the ambiance is I have it on the other side of my 5-gallon water jug that I use to dispense fresh water. So as it lights up, it diffracts through the water. And yeah, oh, it's a very, nice. It's a very pleasant soft like light that comes on in the morning. So yeah, that's one of my rituals when I am waking up as early as I should be. But man, it is, I'm having a hard time getting to sleep when I ought to get to sleep and spending nights in my own bed. Not for that cool reason, but traveling for work, you know, and spending some time in, you know, I'm spending almost one night a week in a hotel, and that does mess up the process of getting to sleep early. And then also just, you know, hanging out with my friends who have 9-to-5 jobs and going on dates. I mean, it is hard to be ideally my alarm or my reminder mocks me every day at 8:45 to say, hey, time to get in that bed. And, you know, sometimes I'm just ordering food at 8:45 when I'm on a date or something. And it's like, oh boy, this is going to be, you know, I can still wake up at 5 tomorrow, but it's not going to feel great.
I wonder if there's got to be some sort of impact on making you feel guilty. Like maybe we should just get rid of that whole reminder. I'm wondering if making you feel guilty is worse than actually having it.
Actual guilt.
I mean, do you actually even use it? Like, even if you are home in your camper and have that bed available to you, when it goes off, do you use it?
Oh, that's a good question.
Because I have the same alarm.
Yeah,
I don't. I'm asking you because I don't. Yeah. And all it does is make me feel bad about myself.
That's fair. Yeah, I'm trying to think. Even if I was sitting at my desk working on something not urgent, or if I was watching a TV show at my desk,
it's just like an annoying.
And it goes off. Am I actually going to say, okay, I'm going to pause this. I'm going to turn my monitor off, and I'm going to go lay in bed. I can't imagine that happening.
Never done it.
So yeah, you're right. I think I should probably let's do that.
I'm going to get rid of mine right now, too. You know, and how stupid am I? I had this set for Friday nights too. Like, really?
That's pretty stupid.
Yeah. Unbelievable. All right.
Let's see.
Done. Updated. Removed. Guilt released.
All right. I've got to go to the health part, and let's see. Yeah, my ideal schedule is bedtime at 8:45, wake up at 4:30.
Wow.
That is – and I would like to live that life consistently, but I just have not been able to figure out how to do it.
I think in the wintertime, it needs to be a different schedule. I think looking at the way we are as human beings and so tied to the earth and the sun and everything in terms of our wake cycles and our eating cycles, I think – we're swimming upstream thinking we're going to be able to get up at the same time early in the summer as we do in the winter.
Well, we certainly can. It's just how difficult will it be, and what are the trade-offs, right?
Exactly. Yeah. How exhausted are we going
to
be?
But you do have to offset that with, okay, but what's the value of the established pattern where I'm just the guy who, like The Rock, I'm a guy who wakes up at 4:30. Like that's who I am.
I'd love to talk to The Rock in the wintertime. Is he really still getting up at 4:30? I really would like to know. Or does he kind of take it easy, sleep in? And I think we all ease into that because of the holidays too. We get those days off where we don't need to wake up with an alarm.
Yeah, but
and then before we know it, our circadian rhythm is
The Rock or Jocko Willink. I'll bet they are doing it every day, no matter what the conditions are. And I know The Rock started doing it because of, you know, his shooting. When you're shooting movies and TV shows and stuff like that, you know, you have to get up so early, getting hair and makeup and all that stuff.
I mean, making millions of dollars is quite an incentive. If I was pulling in The Rock's paycheck, yeah, no problem. I'd be getting up.
See that? I'll disagree with you because I think that that's a common thing that people like to do, to say, If I had this on the line, then I would do it. But the only way you get that kind of stuff on the line is by already being the kind of person that does those things.
So you think The Rock was so successful because he's getting up at 4:30 consistently first.
I think he's successful because he's the kind of guy that decides, all right, if this is what it takes, then this is what I'm going to do.
Yeah. Well, you got to remember.
And I think he's probably doing that in lots of areas of his life.
The Rock started early. If you watched the show, was it Young Rock or whatever it was? Yeah.
I didn't see it, but I knew about it.
But he was a football player from a young age, right. And training and everything else like that builds that discipline and that habit. So he's got that ingrained in his DNA, I think, at this point.
Yeah. The whole idea of being comfortable, being uncomfortable is what will let you set those patterns and live with those patterns. And, just trying to implement some of that stuff when you're in your late 30s or 40s, it is an uphill battle, but you can still win uphill battles. Just because something's an uphill battle doesn't mean you're definitely going to lose.
It just means expect it to be hard.
Exactly. All right, let's jump into our material this week. We are still covering Self-Care for Men, How to Look Good and Feel Great by Garrett Muntz, and we're going to talk about mani-pedis.
Nice.
So you should clean your nails and cut them because the people in your life will appreciate it, and because it's better to stop your fingers from falling off and being gross.
Yep.
Being gross first, then falling off, I would say.
Bacteria love to live under those little buggers, and
yes,
you know, we're touching everything.
How often do you trim yours?
Whenever they need it. So it depends on the time of the year. So I just kind of look at them every once in a while. So they grow faster in the summer, slower in the winter. So it's could be as much as a week and a half or 2 weeks.
Really, that long? I can't go that long.
Yeah.
Yeah. I'm usually like every probably around a week.
Okay.
5, 6, 8 days, something like that.
Yeah.
And sometimes I'll just notice, I'll look down and I'll notice like, oh, okay, they need to be attended to.
Yeah. I don't cut them super short. And because of that, and I mean, I guess maybe, you know, they don't grow that fast, but they're a little bit, they need a little bit of work.
They're not too bad.
A little bit longer than this and I'm cutting them.
Okay.
Just so you know where I'm at.
Yeah. I try to cut them as close to the part where they change from pink to white as I can.
Yeah. So I actually dated a woman once where she freaked out and said, don't cut your nails too short. Cause I guess she had an ex-boyfriend who did, and he ended up like
doing some damage.
And so she got me kind of a little paranoid about that too. So I let it go a little bit longer, but not to the point of where I'm scratching myself or people or whatever. If I feel like I like catch my nail on something, that's when I'll look and I'll be like,
all right,
I'll either file it down or I'll cut them depending on what's going on.
Yeah. I need to do a better job of filing them and buffing them. Cause I like the way, you know, I've never applied a polish or anything, but when you get one of those like 6th grade sanding things where it goes from rough to very fine and your nails get all shiny. Yeah. I like the way that looks. I should do that more often, or go to a professional and let them do it. So, your hands are obviously the primary way that you deal with the world as far as touch goes, right?
Yep.
And, as a result, they're more likely to have some of the roughest skin on your body unless, I mean, yeah, you and I mostly touch keyboards for a living. So the only areas I have any roughness on are right here and right here.
Mm-hmm.
And that's from gripping a barbell.
Oh, I thought it was something else. It's the size of a barbell. But a question for, do you use hand sanitizers ever?
Rarely.
Yeah.
I would rather wash my hands than use hand sanitizer.
Yeah, me too. And I don't know if this happens to you, but every time I use it, my nails break.
Oh, really?
They chip.
Yeah. Okay. Interesting. Well, I mean, you could probably alter your technique a little bit so you're not rubbing the alcohol directly on the fingernail.
Yes. And I've done that. And I've also bought some stuff from Amazon. It's basically like a nail strengthening. It's like a moisturizer, a nutrient type of little polish. It's clear. And it's just like a moisturizer. And it might be what they use in the salons. And I rub that in every time I use the sanitizer. And that seems to have helped.
Interesting. The only time I really prefer sanitizer, some people may think this is gross and that's fine, but I sometimes when I'm on the road and I have to stop and use the restroom in a really gross bathroom, I'm like, I would rather not even wash my hands in this bathroom, even though I just got done using the bathroom.
You're not the only one who's done that. I would rather
go out to my car
and
hand sanitizer. Well, I mean, I'm, you know, I think,
dude, some of those
between COVID and other stuff, it's like you always have to wash your hands right after you use the bathroom. Yeah,
but not if it's covered in bacteria and dirt and like some of the sinks are disgusting.
Yeah, and then the door handle that you have to touch
because
no thing on the. I like that. Like every McDonald's now and every McDonald's.
Yeah,
and there's one other place that has the thing on the bottom of the door where you can use your foot to open it and you don't have to touch it. And listen, I am no germ freak by any means, but some bathrooms that I'm in, I'm like, I don't want to touch anything in here. It's so gross.
I've used my foot to lift the lid on the toilet because it looked so nasty.
Yeah.
You know, but I'm not.
That's the other, that one idiosyncrasy of mine is I do not ever want to sit down to use a toilet with a black toilet seat.
Okay.
Because you can't see what's going on the seat. That grosses me out. So if I have to go I go into like a gas station bathroom and they got black lids on the seats, I'm like, nope, get back in the car, try the next place.
I'll do like a makeshift toilet seat cover with the toilet paper, and I'll just kind of cover the back and then the sides and the front, and I'll cover it like completely with toilet paper if I've got a. I guess I could try hovering. I got some decent odds.
Oh, yeah.
You know, the girls do it all the time.
Yeah.
You know?
I don't like to hover. The other thing I will do in a public
room. A little bit of extra splash. Is that the concern there?
I just want to relax. I don't know how tough things are going
to
be.
I'm not in there to relax. I'm in there to relieve.
I don't know how tough things are going to be with the actual, you know, exercise of using the restroom. So. I want just a little bit. That's the reason why.
It is a restroom, I guess.
Thank you.
Okay. All right. I'll give you that.
The other thing I like to do is treat myself to two of the little seat cover things, the disposable seat covers.
Okay.
Yeah. Don't just use one. Use two. Treat yourself. It's nice.
Treat yourself.
It's very luxurious. Feels good. Did you ever in the 80s, did you ever have in your house or in a friend's house the padded toilet seats?
Yes.
Those are so gross.
I had it at my dad's house.
They feel good.
They were amazing. But it was only my own house. It wasn't anybody else's house.
Just think about how gross that is, just the idea that there's foam underneath that vinyl. Ugh. I hope we've moved past that as a society. That is so disgusting. Okay. Anyway, back to Manny Petties. If you work with your hands, then you should take care of them. If you wear sandals ever, you need to take care of your feet. I don't know. Is that because people will see your feet, or is that because your feet will get gross because you wear sandals? I don't know what the logic is when he said that.
I would think it's probably your feet are going to get gross from wearing sandals. And the other thing is you're not wearing socks. So whatever was on your feet, that little is now in the sandal, and a lot of sandals, they're either some carpet. Oh my God. Some textured, right. Something that might absorb some of that dirt and stuff. And knowing that we absorb a lot of nutrients and things through our feet, like Epsom salt baths, they have foot baths where you just put your feet in it and it helps you relax. Our feet absorb a lot of stuff. So we really want to take good care of the feet, keep them clean as much as possible. And that even, did you ever look at the bottom of sandals, how like black and dark they are?
Yeah.
Yeah. So I know I haven't been as diligent to clean them as I should.
I assume that's probably just skin oil, and then the oil captures dust and dirt and stuff. And
fingers crossed.
Yeah.
I wonder if there's got to be somebody who's done studies, like samples of bacteria.
Yeah. Dissected an old pair of Birkenstocks and reported out what they found.
Or Crocs, whatever, right?
Well,
at least the Crocs, you can wear socks with them.
Ugh. Yeah, I suppose you could, but I will, you know, if you're doing that and you're over the age of 14, I'm going to look down on you.
Yeah, and also they're like a rubber, so they're less likely to
soak
up.
Yeah, and I actually recently, I donated my real Birkenstocks, which, you know, the real Birkenstocks are like they're $100, $110 for a pair of those.
I remember. Leather ones. I remember when you could only get them in Germany as a kid.
Yeah.
My mom and I we'd go to Germany, and that was her big thing. Go to the shoe store, get Birkenstocks. And I was like, these things are ugly, you know, but she loved them, and they were uncomfortable. I mean, it was like made out of there was no like memory foam or anything
I read some articles that actually said the originals are better than the memory foam ones. So when I bought them, I bought the originals.
Yeah.
Because the originals break into your feet more than the memory foams do.
Yeah. And that's when my mom was like, oh, you just got to break them in. Well, yeah. How long does that take? Like, I could be uncomfortable for like a month. Long,
but honestly, they never, my leather and cork Birkenstocks never got as comfortable.
That's right. It's made of cork. Yeah.
Yeah. They never got as comfortable to me as essentially the plastic, like they have the Birkenstocks that are made with essentially the same stuff they make Crocs out of.
Okay.
And I got those first, and I went through a few pairs of those.
And those
first.
Mold to your feet too.
A little bit, but they're so light and they're my favorite sandals. I don't know what that kind of plastic is called, EVA or whatever, but they're the most comfortable sandals I've ever owned. Wow. And the real Birkenstocks just, I found myself never wanting to wear them because they just didn't feel as good.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, if they weren't appropriate for a lot of situations. So I eventually just donated them probably a few weeks ago. I was still in New Smyrna. So I donated them over there, and I was like, yeah, I'm never wearing these. So why am I keeping them in my closet?
Yeah.
Somebody else can wear them.
Yeah. I'd see my mom's, I'd be like, this looks like a bed of nails. No, thank you. I was like, this is not my cup of tea.
But yeah, if I had never tried the very lightweight plasticky rubber ones first, I may have been a bigger fan of them, those lightweight ones, and they sell them at, you know, I think I usually got them at Dick's or on Amazon for like $45, $49, $39, something like that. So they're a lot less expensive and they feel so good. And, so
maybe I need to give them a shot.
I would try them out. Okay. So, professional manicures and pedicures are low cost and low risk, but do wonders for your mood, not to mention your hygiene. Again, for me, pedicures, man, it's got to be a special occasion where I'm going to be spending a lot of time barefoot or in sandals, because I just get tickled too easily when I'm getting my toes and my feet touched. So I don't do those near as often as I do manicures.
When you were getting pedicures, did they do the loofah type of scrub for the bottom of your feet for the dead skin cells, or did they bust out the cheese grater?
I think I've probably gotten both.
Okay.
I think the stone they use on sort of the sides of my heel a little bit.
Okay.
But the bottom of my feet are so soft that they're...
Must be nice.
It is. They're... Yeah, that's
even with all that hiking and walking you're doing there.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. I don't know if that's, walking doesn't typically make the bottom of my feet, harden up.
Okay.
And I don't know if that's because of the socks and the shoes that I'm wearing or what, but, my feet stay very soft in my palms. I mean, the first time I shake hands with a woman, the first thing they usually say is your hands are, I wish my hands were that soft. And it's like, yeah,
I wish my hands were that soft.
Not doing anything. but yeah, I've had a lot of pedicures, a lot of pedicures. I mean, there's some people probably doing every week. I've had a few dozen pedicures and I'm always just kind of, I feel uncomfortable. And
I get the tickling when they're doing the pumice stone or the cheese grater. I mean, my feet definitely need the cheese grater for sure to get all that stuff off. And sometimes they'll think they can get by with the pumice stone. And I'm like, did you check? Cause they're still like rocks.
Oh, wow. Yeah.
Yeah.
I've never had to deal with that on the bottom of my feet. All right. So, you know, a lot of the stuff in this, I really think most of the things that the reasons that he's selling, go get professional manicures and pedicures. It's cause it feels nice. Like, I don't know that they're, from a hygiene perspective, I don't know that there's a lot of benefit to manicures and pedicures that I'm not getting myself from what I do in the shower, what I do when I wash my hands. I mean, they do put some nice lotions and stuff on me that I wouldn't normally do for myself, but just from a hygiene perspective, I mean, my feet get pretty clean when I'm in the shower, not only because I wash them, but because all the other things I wash end up on my feet.
Yeah.
You know, the soap,
correct.
The soap gets down there.
Yep.
And then I also do a little once over the tops and the bottoms of my feet while I'm in the shower. So I, you know, when he goes into the bacteria and the fungus, it's like, okay, well, if you're showering regularly and you're washing your feet while you shower.
Yeah.
I don't know that you should be fine.
And I think if you're taking showers in public places, like at the gym, things like that, you're not wearing sandals into the shower, you're more likely to get something on your feet. I mean, just same thing after the gym. I wash my hands twice, actually, for 20 seconds after I leave the gym every single day, because there's nobody going around wiping stuff down or anything else like that. And
you know, knock on wood, I rarely get sick. But that's just a habit that I've gotten into. The other thing I think is good to the reason why it's good to get professional any of these services is so you can see what the right way is to do these things. Yeah. And then you can bring it back and say, okay, look, I don't need all this other stuff.
Yeah.
I can just do, at least I know the right way to do it. I can do it on my own and save a couple of bucks if you wanted to, or do it a little bit more often.
That's the same mindset that we talked about before about, you know, when you're looking to change up your style, as far as your haircut goes, go to the most expensive place in town.
Exactly.
Have them do it for you. Then have your friend take pictures of your head from every angle. And then 2 weeks when you need another haircut, go to your usual cheap barber and say, make my hair look like this. And it's a way to establish the baseline the high line and say, this is what it is at its best. So now I've got something to shoot for.
Yeah.
And so, yeah, I could
great idea.
I could see value in doing things that way as well. Let's go through, if you've never been to a spa for a manicure or a pedicure, I just want to go quickly through what they do, real quickly. First, they're going to clean your nails to get whatever dirt and oil and grime is on them off. Then they're going to cut your nails with a nail clipper, based on how long you want them and what shape you want them. And
usually they start like with a soak first. Is that what they?
I don't know if they do the soak first. I think they do the soak before they push your cuticles back and start and get out the little tiny, the little snippers where they go after the dead skin around your nail.
Gotcha.
Yeah, so they'll cut your nails. Usually you want rounded. I always cut mine to basically match the shape of the tip of my finger. I suppose there are other options for guys besides that, but
I don't know if I've ever seen to be honest with you, and I think that would look like weird.
Sharp edges or
I mean on, you know, women when they get their nails
right
on options. Yeah, I've seen, you know,
I've seen straight, I've seen very curved, I've seen pointy. I've seen a lot with women, but man, nothing makes me feel both uncomfortable and a little bad for women than seeing women with long fingernails trying to use a keyboard. It's like, oh, that looks not fun, man. I appreciate.
And you're also very sensitive to sounds and noises. So I'm wondering if the click, 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 click would eventually drive you nuts.
It might a little bit.
You know, because the nail's either on the keyboard or on the other keys.
Yes. Like constantly. That's the question. Are you using your nail or are you using the flat part of the pad? I don't know.
I think they've done, depends on the woman. I think you can do both.
Oof. Yeah, just another thing to have to decide. Burn through that decision-making willpower.
Exactly.
Speaking of sounds, the one sound that does drive me absolutely loony is hearing another person cut their nails.
Oh, the clip?
Yes.
Clip.
That's not ASMR for you? The keyboard, nails on a chalkboard, and the clipping might be your next ASMR.
Nails on a chalkboard might be easier for me than hearing somebody clip their nails.
Interesting.
When I had a partner.
Do you have some sort of childhood trauma around this?
Not that I know of.
Okay.
You know, maybe. I mean, if my partner is cutting their nails, I'll be like, I'm going for a walk.
I have a little PTSD about that clipping sound as well. I had a roommate shortly after college who would clip his toenails in the living room. It was an apartment where like three of us were living together. Mm-hmm. And he'd just sit in the living room watching TV. Yeah.
Shoot him around the room.
Basically.
Yeah.
Not knowing where it goes. You might find it on the couch. You might find it in your cereal. Who knows?
That's the idea of getting in your food.
Ugh.
Oh, my God.
Makes me sick just thinking about it.
Yeah.
I could deal with hair in my food. A fingernail, no way.
Oh, I can't deal with either.
If I can deal with hair, no problem.
If I find hair in my food, the meal's over.
Yeah. Yeah, a lot of people are like that. Ugh. I'm okay with hair, believe it or not, as long as it's not too long.
Yeah. Oh,
if it's like already in my mouth and then like I'm pulling it out and I'm feeling it like kind of grind against like my teeth or my throat, that's where, okay, that's too much.
I hope TikTok bans us for this. Oh my gosh. All right. So they cut your nails, then they're going to file your nails to get the kind of shape you want. And it's funny. It was the first time I went to get a manicure that I realized I was filing my nails wrong. Because you're supposed to file your nails like this, along the edge, and I would file them like this. So I'm taking off some levels of the top of the nail too when I would file
them. Interesting.
Yeah, you'll like they'll put like the file under the corner and stuff, and they'll like the sides where you should not go against the grain like this when you file.
Oh no, yeah. Okay. And I don't do it. Okay.
It's so much faster if you do it that way. You just stick your hand up like this and then just
file. Oh my gosh, like that's hysterical.
I
don't get like under the corners, but I will go like around the top like that.
Yeah, that's fine.
Kinda, you know, or I'll do like this and then this and then this. Kinda, yeah, you know,
going perpendicular to the way your finger goes, you should not do.
Yeah, okay. And a little splinter. Yeah, yeah.
I learned that.
I mean, just like cutting a good piece of meat, you know, you got to go with the grain.
All right. Then after you're filed, you'll get soaked. And then after you soak is when they will push your cuticles back and then get out those little snippers, which I'm always shocked that I don't end up a bloody mess when they get those little snipping tools.
Oh, to get the cuticles at the bottom of that? Yeah.
How am I not bleeding? But I guess they're just going after dead skin.
Yeah. You know, and the funny thing is, I don't ever see it. And yet I feel like sometimes they're just going through the motions, I feel, because I don't like see any dead skin on my cuticles.
Oh, they get a ton off of mine. It's gross.
And I'm like, are you doing anything?
They get a lot.
Okay.
Yeah, like the pile of skin that builds up around the corner when they're doing that. It's,
okay.
Yeah, it's nasty. Yeah, they get a lot off mine.
Delicious.
Then after they do that part, then they'll moisturize your hands, give you a little massage, which is nice, and then buff or polish them at the end. So there you go, guys. That's what you're missing out on if you're not getting
If you've never had a good hand massage or a good foot massage, it's amazing because we don't realize how much we're actually using. And it's kind of one of those things where it's like low level stress, right? Yeah. Like we're using our hands and feet so much all day long. And we just get used to it being stiff and tight. Same thing with like our forearms. So to actually, when somebody actually gets in there and does a massage, it's like, holy cow. One, it's almost a little painful because I didn't realize how tight I was, but two, I need to do this more often.
Yeah, I am overdue for going for a manicure. But the thing is, I rarely go to get them because when I notice my fingers are too long, I just trim them.
Me too.
And then I'm like, it'd be a waste to go get a manicure now. I've already trimmed them. Where that's just a small part of what they do is the actual trimming, but I use it to talk myself out of it.
I'm exactly the same way.
Yeah, so I should use the act of trimming my nails as a reminder of, you should go get a manicure. And okay, so I mean, usually manicures for guys are fairly inexpensive because they're just not doing a lot of stuff to you anyway.
But they're going to ask you every single time if you want color. That's like the running joke at all those salons, by the way. Every time I go, they wink at me and they laugh at you want color?
Could do just one nail black like Carson Daly in the early 2000s, late 90s.
Oh, I didn't know Carson started that trend.
I think he did. Yeah. I noticed it when he was hosting TRL, Total Request Live on MTV.
And that wasn't because he smashed his finger with a hammer?
I think it was an aesthetic choice.
Carson Daly
didn't look like a guy who's picking up a hammer to me. So I think it's probably you don't have tips that frosted if you're working with hammers on a daily basis.
I don't know these days.
I mean, yeah, but this was late 90s.
Ah, yeah.
So, you know,
him and Vanilla Ice.
We were a little less tolerant back then.
Ironically, Vanilla Ice had a home improvement show, or he's a big guy. He was big into construction, actually, when he came back.
Oh, the best home improvement show of all time was the Adam Carolla Project on TLC. It was so much fun. He bought his dad's
house. That sounds familiar.
Bought his dad's house from him.
Uh-huh.
And then decided to renovate it and sell. And he hired all of his loser high school friends to come work with him.
Hysterical.
It was very funny.
We got to look that up.
I downloaded it.
I would love to see that.
I downloaded it off something. It might have been like one of the, you know, LimeWire or Kazaa or BitTorrent. I don't remember when I downloaded it, but it was all available. You could watch all of it. It might be on YouTube now for free.
So it's like a whole season.
Yeah, he did like a whole season of fixing up his dad's house. And
I wouldn't mind throwing a couple shekels his way for that.
I don't know. He probably doesn't have the rights to sell it, so it might... Maybe if you subscribe to whatever TLC's streaming service is whichever one TLC is on, you could get it. But I don't know. It'd be interesting to see how it holds up. I'm sure it was very funny, though. Him and his buddies, just a bunch of screw-ups. And it's, you know, him getting frustrated and yelling at them most of the time because he's obviously very funny. He's also a very good carpenter. So he knows how stuff's supposed to get done right.
And he's like a race car driver. Yes. I mean, the guy is he like a genius? Is he been, has he talked about that? Because I feel like
he is,
I've heard these things where he's like, he's not just good. He's really good at a lot of really things. Yeah. Yeah.
And, very,
to me, that's a sign
very uneducated, dropped out of junior college. And, you know, he's the one that I stole
traditionally uneducated.
I stole the phrase, I know everything because I know nothing. That was him that originally came up with that.
Oh, wow.
I mean, I don't have a bunch of formal education in my head to get in the way of my common sense.
I feel like Rogan took a little bit of that, right? With his, with his expression.
Yeah. So, anyway, great show. Okay. So how to choose the right place. Go to a place that's got some online reviews, ideally positive ones, not negative ones. And, you always want to see people opening up the little baggie that the tools are in. And that's how you know that they've been sterilized since the last person used them. You know, I use online reviews for everything, whether it's on Amazon or Google or Yelp. It's like if a place doesn't have a high number of reviews and they're mostly positive. Now, every place is going to have a couple people who had a bad experience. And usually the people with bad experiences are the ones that actually write reviews. Where, you know, if somebody has a good experience, like for me personally, I'll click on the 5-star, but I won't usually write out my experience.
That's probably more than what most people do.
Yeah. So, you know, there is a negative bias, I would say, with reviews in general, but I'd still use them before I would pick a place to work on my fingernails or toenails.
And it's funny that you mentioned that because I wanted to ask, these days, besides Yelp and Google reviews, are there any other platforms that you use that have a decent amount of reliable reviews for either for food, for, you know, these manicure pedicure places?
No, I've pretty much given up on Yelp too, where I only do Google reviews.
Yelp gets a little confusing with the sponsored ads at the top.
Yes, exactly.
And it gets a little bit frustrating.
Yes. Yeah. I don't know. It's like, oh, is this place at the top of the list because it's the best or because they threw a few bucks Yelp's way? Yeah. So I generally, use Google Maps. And like when I go, one of the things I do to relax when I'm on solo travel is at the end of the day, I'll usually get on my phone and do Google Maps reviews for the places that I've gone that day. And, sometimes, you know, if I've taken pictures there, I'll upload
pictures.
Yeah. Just one of the things I like doing laying in the bed in a hotel or a hostel while I'm getting ready to go to sleep is just sort of go through my day and upload some reviews. And some of them, you know, seem to be useful to people. And, it's a
great
way to remember the trip. Okay, so here's how to do a DIY pedicure. We'll go through this real quick if you're not ready to go and let a professional touch your feet. Soak your feet in a bath of warm water and Epsom salt for about 10 minutes. While still in the soak, use a foot scrub to exfoliate dead skin and get rid of calluses. And pumice stone, and again, depending on your level of hardness, will kind of determine the tool that's necessary. Clip your toenails with a straight edge clipper. Be careful not to cut them too short because then you can get infected and fungus and things like that. File the edges with a nail file or emery board and then apply a moisturizing foot cream all over your feet and between your toes and rub it in completely. So there you go. That's your process. I'm not sure how long we've been going, but I think we're at a good point to stop. So let's call it for now. And then on our next episode, we will talk about at least lotions, and maybe we'll get into the secondary topic as well, because I don't have a lot to say about lotions, and I kind of didn't feel like the author had that much to say about them either.
I mean, how much can you say about lotions?
Yeah. So we'll see next week. All right. Thanks, Dan. I'll talk to you soon.
Bye-bye.
Bye. Wow, you made it through the whole thing, so you must like us at least a little bit, in which case you should definitely follow or subscribe to our show in your chosen podcast app. Thanks. We'll talk to you next time.